Today's Planet Earth, Our Living Home, will be presented in Urdu, with subtitles in Arabic, Olaxese or Vietnamese, Chinese, English, French, German, Indonesian, Japanese, Korean, Malay, Persian, Portuguese, Russian, Thai, Urdu, and Spanish. Assalamu alaikum, mahol dost nazreen. اور ہمارے پروگرام زمین ہمارا پیارا گھر میں خوش آمدید. آج کی قسط میں ہم بات کریں گے پروفیسر سلیم ایچ علی سے, جو کہ ایک پاکستانی نژاد امریکی اسکالر ہیں اور ماحولیاتی علوم کے پروفیسر ہیں یونیورسٹی آف ورمونٹ امریکہ میں. اس کے ساتھ ساتھ پروفیسر وابستہ ہیں پاکستان میں ماحولیاتی تحفظ اور تحفظ برائے معدنی ذرائع کے ساتھ. پروفیسر علی نے کئی ایک اہم مقالے تحریر کیے ہیں ماحول کو محفوظ کرنے پر, اور حال ہی میں لکھی ایک کتاب جس کا عنوان ہے زمین کے خزانے, ضرورت, لالچ اور ایک قابل برداشت مستقبل. اس کتاب میں بحث کی گئی ہے کہ انسان کیسے نکال سکتے ہیں اور استعمال میں لا سکتے ہیں زمین کے اندر کی نعمتوں کو, جیسا کہ لوہا اور سونا, نہایت ہی ماحولیاتی ذمہ دارانہ طریقے سے. پروفیسر صاحب جانے جاتے ہیں اپنی ثالثی صلاحیت کی وجہ سے بھی اور بہت سے امانت داروں کے درمیان مسائل کے حل کرنے میں مدد کرنے کے لیے جب بھی کسی ترقیاتی منصوبے سے زمین پر اثر پڑتا ہو.
I also teach another class which is on environmental conflict resolution. And that's more of a seminar class where I use some of the techniques I developed in my research and practice in resolving disputes between corporations and communities on environmental issues. So for example, the development of a new mine in some community, so it could be the development of a new highway.
پروفیسر علی امریکہ میں پیدا ہوئے اور اس وقت پاکستان چلے گئے جب ان کی عمر 9 سال تھی. وہ کہتے ہیں ان کی تعلیم اور تربیت نے انہیں مشرق اور مغرب کے درمیان تہذیبی فرق کو اچھی طرح سے سمجھنے کی صلاحیت فراہم کی ہے, اور نیز یہ کہ ایک منفرد تناظر میں ماحولیاتی مسائل کو حل کرنے کی تحقیق میں مدد فراہم کی. پاکستان میں رہتے ہوئے انہوں نے قومی ماحولیاتی تحریک میں بہت بڑی ترقی دیکھی ہے.
During the 1980s, there was a lot of positive energy around understanding some of the environmental challenges in Pakistan. There was a rise of civil society around environmental issues. For example, the World Wildlife Fund had one of their largest operations in Asia in Pakistan in the 80s. IUCN, the World Conservation Union, had a huge field office in Pakistan, which also emerged in the 80s. It was a time when, you know, you could really feel that need for environmental action. There was a drive to try and solve those problems.
گوشت کی پیداوار اور کھپت کا یہ دائرہ ذمہ دار ہے بہت بڑی مقدار میں انسانوں کی پیدا کردہ گرین ہاؤس گیس کے اخراج کے لیے. ماضی میں حکومت پاکستان نے گوشت کا ناغہ کے دن مقرر کیے, جنہوں نے ماحول کے لیے غیر معمولی فائدہ پہنچایا.
Actually, there were 2 days which were meatless days in the week, and no meat was allowed to be sold during those days. Mm-hmm. It was partly aimed at reducing overall meat consumption because the economy just could not sustain that level of meat production, and to get people consider other markets as well for vegetable goods and so on. And I think it was effective. I felt that it was very ecologically responsible, even though the government may not have intentioned it to be that way, but it had a positive impact and I didn't feel deprived in any way. So I hope that, you know, people can make an individual choice to not consume more meat, but if it doesn't happen individually, I think government can nudge people in the right direction, mm-hmm, by having such provisions. And Pakistan's neighbor India, of course, is a Hindu majority country, and most Hindus do not eat meat at all. They're entirely vegetarian. And I have also noticed that Muslims in India, they consume much less meat than Muslims in Pakistan, because there has been some positive, I think, cultural crossover there on that issue.
पाकिस्तान में इस वक्त लोगों की फलाह बहबूद के सिलसिले में पेशरफ्त हो रही है बहुत से माहौलियाती मंसूबों के ज़रिए। प्रोफेसर अली के मुताबिक
The government has been moderately successful at some levels. They've tried to, for example, improve their agricultural practices a little bit. We've had a time when there was tremendous wastage of water, for example, in Pakistan, where there were several canals made that were not very well designed, and it led to salinity and water logging, and it's a highly agricultural country. The government has increasingly realized some of those problems. They're trying to address those.
पाकिस्तान में गैर हकूमती तंजीमें बहुत से इदारे और लोग अपने तौर पर एक अहम किरदार अदा कर रहे हैं माहौलियात के बारे में जानकारी और हिफाजत के लिए।
We do have a very strong social network within the country. Part of it has come out of necessity because we weren't getting many tourists, we weren't getting much foreign investment, and so people had to become self-reliant. So that did lead to these institutions evolving, and in some ways people have become very inventive. They've found ways, even environmentally, to lower their ecological footprint out of necessity. So for example, Pakistan has one of the highest prevalence of compressed natural gas being used in cars. There are about 2 million cars which are running on compressed natural gas rather than on petrol. Mm-hmm. And that's environmentally much better, of course. You have a lower carbon footprint. And that happened out of necessity because the cost of fuel became so high. People were able to, retrofit vehicles and find the technology on their own, more or less, to do this. Many times there was just the inventiveness of the people and they did that. So in those ways, the country has been very resilient to be able to manage those issues.
जब हम वापस आएंगे तो प्रोफेसर सलीम अली बात करेंगे कि वसाइल को इस्तेमाल करने और माहौल को बचाने में हम तवाज़ुन कैसे हासिल कर सकते हैं। बराए मेहरबानी देखते रहिए सुप्रीम मास्टर टेलीविज़न।
This is Salim Ali from the University of Vermont, and you're watching Supreme Master Television.
प्रोग्राम ज़मीन हमारा मोहब्बत भरा घर में खुश आमदीद, जहाँ हमारे मेहमान हैं पाकिस्तानी स्कॉलर प्रोफेसर सलीम अली, जो अमरीका में रहते हैं। वो ज़मीन के मादनी वसाइल को महफूज करने के उलूम में माहिर हैं।
In some cases, we do need minerals for much of our modern lives, but they need to be harnessed with utmost care, and we need to be very aware of their non-renewability, that once the mining stops, you have to leave a viable ecosystem, a viable environment, so that people can then go back to some other livelihoods, and that the money that comes from the mining can be reinvested in the community. So it's part of a development trajectory, and that it's not just a be-all and an end-all where the companies just come in and get what they want and then they leave. So there is a right way to do it. So we're hopeful that there can be some best practices which evolve around how companies operate in communities. There are some examples which are emerging. For example, I was in Australia last year, and I visited one of the world's largest diamond mines, the Argyle Diamond Mine, which is in Western Australia. And the mine was developed after a very protracted negotiation between the indigenous people, the Aboriginal communities in that area, and the mining company. And the agreement involved some respect of sacred sites of the Aboriginal communities, ability of those communities to visit those sites, to have access, to also have some arrangements for revenue sharing in various ways. And so that's been a positive development. The agreement was one of the earliest, so it still needs to be refined, I think. But I think they're on the right track. Other examples you have are where indigenous communities are themselves owners of mines, and then they have a stake in making sure that the practices are better than they would be otherwise. So there's, for example, the Red Dog mine in Alaska, where it's the Native Corporation in Alaska, the Nana Corporation, owns part of the mine, and it's a Canadian company, Teck Cominco, which manages it. And there are environmental challenges with that, but the community has a direct vigilance in terms of them living there. They're partly the owners of the mine, to be able to make sure that things are addressed. So that kind of arrangement can provide some safety nets for mining operations. It's very important to have good restoration plans. Once the mining stops, you have to be able to restore the landscape. That should be a cost of doing business. It's really something that the company has to be held accountable for.
प्रोफेसर अली कुदरती वसाइल के काबिले ताईद इस्तेमाल पर अपनी राय मजीद बयान करते हैं।
In modern societies, we have to grapple with three competing goals. On the one hand, you have ecological conservation as an important goal, but the life support systems that sustain the planet in many ways are the fundamental base from which we have to operate. But then there are two other competing goals too. One is of poverty alleviation and inequality. We have to grapple with that challenge. And the third is the quest for democratic pluralism and individual choice at some level, that you need to be able to allow people to have some measure of choice. That choice can be regulated, it can be channeled appropriately through ethics, through government, through different social mechanisms. But that still remains an important goal that we aspire towards. When we are trying to balance these three,
अपनी हालिया किताब में जिसका उन्वान ज़मीन के खजाने ज़रूरत लालच और काबिले तायद मुस्तकबिल है प्रोफेसर अली मादनी वसाइल के इस्तेमाल और माहौल की हालत के बारे में और इन तरीकों के बारे में बात करते हैं जिनको इस्तेमाल करके हम ज़्यादा मौसर और ज़्यादा माहौल दोस्त निज़ाम बना सकते हैं
You want to get rid of the term waste. Altogether, in some sense, so that everything that is being used through its life cycle can then be channeled and reused in some form or another. Ultimately, the laws of physics will demand that you have to put in some energy at some point to be able to get that material out and reuse it in some form. That energy also then needs to be considered in sustainable terms. And that's the concept that I'm trying to get at, that don't just disavow consumption, but make it more responsible, make it more strategic, so that we can address those competing challenges that I mentioned earlier between poverty alleviation, ecological conservation, and individual choice.
Professor Saleem Ali ke baare mein mazeed malumat ke liye brae meherbani dekhiye www.uvm.edu/tildashali प्रोफेसर अली की कुतुब दस्तियाब हैं www.amazon.com हम शुक्रिया अदा करना चाहेंगे प्रोफेसर सलीम अली का कि उन्होंने हमें पाकिस्तान में आने वाले सब जिंदगी की तरफ रुझान के बारे में अपनी आरा से आशना करवाया और दुनिया के मादनी वसाइल की काबिले तायद खपत के बारे में बात की बराए मेहरबानी अगले बुध को हमारा साथ दें प्रोग्राम ज़मीन हमारा मोहब्बत भरा घर में प्रोफेसर अली के इंटरव्यू के दूसरे हिस्से के लिए आज के प्रोग्राम में आपके रहम दिलाना साथ के लिए शुक्रिया दुआ है कि आपकी ज़िंदगी जन्नत की खुदादाद मोहब्बत और रोशनी से भर जाए
For more details, please visit www.suprememastertv.com/PE